all the trees are turned off. So a SketchUp model or an Illustrator document that has your plan handy, what we'll do is we'll in Photoshop we will match as best we can the perspective to what we see experienced in Google Earth. So, but let's just open up Google Earth first and take a look at our context. Fly over it. Login information is on the board. User is your BSU email. Password is the word student. So it asks for login information. Your username is your Ball State email, and the password is student. And I can fly to Muncie. I can also fly to Yorktown. Sometimes it's helpful that the map marker is not in the middle of our view. But on the left-hand side here is the primary database with all of this information. I'm going to turn everything off except for roads, 3D buildings, and terrain. That terrain is going to give me a different type of image once we start to zoom in on the store site. You'll see it. It is a different type of image that has a three-dimensional view of buildings. We can start to see it shaped together. Google also creates shapes for trees based on an algorithm. You can see masses and clumps of trees and clusters of trees. However, you'll notice, wait a minute, the site doesn't look like that anymore because it's a couple of years old. Even though Google shows this as copyright 2020, we can see from the construction progress of certain buildings that this is a couple of years old. I believe it's from 2018 or so. You can tell by the construction on campus whether or not it's progressed. You can see the health building doesn't even exist in this view. So this tells me that this image is approximately from 2017 or 2018. If it were 2018 or later, the health building would actually exist. So that tells you something right there. If you turn off terrain, something happens. You get a little bit more of an accurate image. If we look at the health building, you'll see that the health building is complete if you toggle off the terrain, and you see the foundational science building is just starting. So this puts us, according to this date right here on the lower half, imagery date 9/25/2019. The two-dimensional image in Google Earth is actually more accurate than the three-dimensional image, and that's just a matter of that imagery catching up. You'll also see a couple of 3D buildings that have been built by different geographic folks, including buildings that don't exist anymore. So those 3D buildings are on their own layer. You can toggle those on and off. But just know that Google Earth has two different images on their aerial imagery. In the two-dimensional, you can see we're about in September 2019. If you turn on the terrain and look at the 3D buildings together, it's kind of impressive, though, to look at Village Promenade and things like that. We are probably somewhere in the realm of 2017-2018. Nonetheless, we can fly over our site, even though it still has the elementary school on it. And we can capture a view of it just by using in the upper right, there's a compass that you can move around like this. And then there's a pan that you can fine tune the view with this. And if you ever, one thing to know in Google Earth is if you ever get stuck or you're tired of that particular view, you go to view, reset, tilt, compass, or tilt and compass. These are the most important tools in Google Earth because people get stuck in these different views. And they're like, how do I get back to the map? We go view, reset, tilt and compass. It will write the map and put you back in the overhead plan view. So let's just zoom in on the site, get in there a little bit. You can also, if you hold down the shift key and use your mouse or your trackpad, you can pan the entire world. There's the curvature of the Earth. And we can get really, really pretty low there. You can see it's just like we're flying right over the trees. So play with that, get comfortable with that. Don't get motion sickness, and get an approximate view of the site that you think will work well for this exercise. You're just going to have to play with the compass, this pan, and then holding down the shift key and your trackpad, tilt the earth until you think you're at an angle that would look good for this image. Because we're going to have to do some matching here in a minute. Start recording. All right, to save this view in Google Earth, we go to File, Save, Save Image. Google Earth is going to give you a couple of options for the map. So I go to Map Options. I turn off the title and description, the legend, but I keep the scale and the compass on. But Google Earth has the option to scale those elements. You can see that there's a 200-foot bar and a north arrow down there. Those are good things to keep. But they're a little bit big, so I'm going to type in 50% on that, and it's going to make the scale bar and that north arrow smaller. It doesn't make them go away. It just makes them smaller. So that's a map element, but I've turned off the title, description, legend, all those different things. I've turned all that off. Then Google Earth wants to know what resolution do you want your map to be. So current, which is the Mac Retina screen, 1466 by 875. 10.4 by 768 is a standard, formerly standard PC VGA monitor. 1280 by 720 is 720 HD. 1920 by 1080 is 1080 HD. 3840 by 2160 is 4K. And the max is 4800 pixels wide. That's pretty good. That's pretty good resolution for an image of this size. But I'll probably just go with 720. You can see that it narrows it just a slightly bit, but that 720, that's the aspect ratio for YouTube, aspect ratio for, it also fits on 11 by 17 if you're interested in that, but you're going to be adding these to a 24 by 36. At any rate, you select this resolution here, and then I'll save the image, give it a name, store, aerial, suite, just kidding, aerial sight, bird's eye, give it a name. I'll save it to the desktop, and that will do it. So there's lots of, I think, interesting things about this because it gives you the relative height of the trees, which is really great. And also, you could just examine the soil. You can see that there's something else happening here. Effect of flooding or the effect of tracking or sports or otherwise. Just this aerial view is really interesting because it starts to tell us some things about the site that we already knew or we might be interested in later as we continue our analysis and inventory. But it's great because we've got all this context around it now. We can insert our plan into this view and set it in context, which is one of the objectives we have for this phase of the project. So then we can close out Google Earth. And then, well, we've got to get this SketchUp model approximate so that we can insert it. So it's worth just having the two images open side by side. You all have dual monitors, which is super sweet. I need to open the image and just take a look at its relative vanishing line. So we can see that this is a line that's vanishing to the vanishing point. This is a line vanishing to the vanishing point. I need to get my SketchUp model approximately to that. But I'm going to turn some things off first. One of the things I will want to emphasize before you export, so under View, I'm going to turn off any section cuts, any section fill. I'm going to turn off my axes. I'm going to turn off all the guides. All the guides will go away immediately. I probably don't need that anymore, so that could be on its own layer, or I would so I could turn that layer off, or I could delete it away. But I need to get this thing, I need to pivot this thing so that it's approximately where we want it to be. And then under the styles menu, I want you to play with those. Open up the styles menu and take a look at some of the default styles, the style builder competitions, the sketchy edges. There's some really neat stuff in here in terms of how your model looks. Some are better than others, I could really say, but yikes. But at any rate, but there are some interesting things to think about in the styles menu that are worth exploring. Maybe not at this level, because I can see that a lot of those are not happening right now. Photo modeling is interesting because it's a cyan color that you can isolate and then layer over things. Default, there's the X-ray, there's the shaded, there's the hidden line. So anything hidden line, any model that you have, no matter what the materials are, you can always make a hidden line of it and isolate that if you're interested in some sort of collage effect or photo effect where you have a spotlight. What Devin Levine of Hauzio Levine does, he did a workshop here last year, last October. We have all the video from it, by the way. It's 8 hours of video. Yay. he will export a hidden line and a shaded version of his model, and then he will fuse the two in a collage. It makes a really interesting kind of collage in which the two images are actually layered over each other. And again, we have all that on video. But I need to get this to a point where I think we can work with it, very similar to the image that we've just exported. So I've got the site here, and again, you have the dual screen. So I just need to get this close. It doesn't have to be exact because there's quite a bit we can do it in Photoshop. And the camera does have to have perspective on, probably 2-point perspective, probably not that. Goodness, here we are at the ground level. That's fun. Camera, 2-point perspective. Yeah, 2-point perspective. We'll need that. And then I'll look at this and look at this. The styles menu has some variety, some muted styles, simple. I'll decide if we have the shadows turned on or not. Makes for a very different look, as you can see. I'm going to keep the shadows off. There's a fog that's interesting, kind of fogs out your stuff like that. See that? It's a fade, kind of a fade feel. Here's the fog rolling in. But it just fades some of the things that are in the background out a little bit. I'll just adjust that down, maybe. But I have 2-point perspective on. I've got the shadows turned off. The shadows are just a little bit too dark for me. I have the fog turned on, going into my Bob Ross voice. But I do need to turn off the axes and the guides, make sure those are turned off. And I look back to my Google Earth image, and I'm getting there. I'm getting pretty close to where I think I could work with this thing. Okay. And then I get ready to export 2D graphic. Desktop. Store high density. Perspective. Or bird's eye. I want it to be a PNG, portable network graphic. I click on options. What size was our Google Earth image? So you want it to be relatively close to that, right? The pixel size of your Google Earth image, what was that, 1928 or 1940, something in that realm? Yes? No? So the default view size is going to be your Apple monitor or your PC monitor. But I can punch this up, punch it, Chewy, punch it up to 2,000 pixels or even 3,000 pixels. There's a line scale multiplier that does affect the line weight. We can change that and understand that as a possibility. That will affect the look of the lines. Anti-aliasing is good. Transparent background is good. And then that's ready to export. And then you can take a look at the export. So I did change the line scale multiplier. It made the lines less severe. See what that did? On the screen, the lines are really, really freaking dense. Okay. I have that, and you can see the lines on all those apartments and houses are just a little bit less dense, less severe. So that's a factor that you want to consider when it's ready to export. This is a portable network graphic, so that background around it is completely transparent. That's good, because everybody get to that point?
Adobe programs are getting so big that they take minutes to load because they are so big and so data intense now. All right, open. We will open the Arial site and that PNG together. Open them both up. And we can see that our export has transparent surroundings or background, a little bit of fog on it. And we can see we're in the ballpark, just in terms of this potentially fitting in. Now, first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to double click on the background layer. Well, sorry, first thing I want to do is make sure that I have Window Workspace Painting open. For both Illustrator and for Photoshop, it helps to have a good workspace open because it has a lot of stuff at your fingertips in the right-hand column. It makes for a much better experience and accounts for all the difficulty I had in week one. Remember week one, I'm like, where is everything? And that was the problem, is that I didn't have a workspace open. So workspace painting. I've double-clicked and made this layer 0. I'm going to right-mouse click, duplicate that layer. We'll call it layer 0 copy or layer 0 foreground. Because we need to make a multi-layer sandwich. Foreground layer in front, we're going to tuck in our development layer in the middle and then have it floating on top of the background layer. Okay, we need a foreground layer and a background layer. So I'm going to turn off layer 0, isolate that, and we're going to cut out now a foreground. We'll just grab a lasso and I will start cutting away a foreground layer. This is an aerial, so it's probably just the negative space. I think that would work, but you want to create a lasso that does acknowledge some of these trees in the foreground and just creates a space for our rendered site to tuck in, just like we're tucking it in for the night. Oh, so cute. Such a cute reference. Probably there. We can see our neighbors over there. We do have one tree that's fairly tall. We will find a way to deal with that later. And then to force it to close, I hold down the command key and it will force it to close. That will create a polygonal lasso, and then I will delete that away. So that just creates a hole for our development to slide into. And I will deselect that. Next, I will, we actually can just place that directly into our bird's eye. So I go File, Place Embedded. In Photoshop now you have the option of either placing an embedded image or placing a linked image. You have that option now. Let's do Place Embedded. I will do the High Density Perspective PNG. That is now placed on top. So I will scale that. Holding down the Shift key preserves its aspects. And what I'll do, I'll accept that, but I will quickly now change the opacity of our new thing down so I can see where we are relative to that background layer. And I can make changes to this thing scale-wise, scaling it like so, so that it's getting in there. You also may need to make adjustments to its perspective. So under we have to accept that first. Under Image, under Edit, Transform, Scale, Rotate, Skew, Distort Perspective. Under Edit, Transform, we have Scale, Rotate, Skew, Distort Perspective. All of those tools will help you match this site path to the perspective of your background. Let's try them. So perspective will change the vanishing points. See what that does? Woo! Party! Okay. That might be an option. Press Escape to undo that. Skew is a helpful one. Skew, we grab the corners and we just skew, as the name indicates, duh. Skew the corners to a distorted fashion. This is actually helping me match now the Mansfield Road side a little bit better. Rotate. We may need to rotate this a little bit. I can grab one corner and rotate the whole thing just so it's still, we're getting close. Press Return to accept any changes you make. And then I'll start turning up the opacity to see how it looks. So I'm not there yet, but I'm getting there. So a bunch of fun tools under Edit, Transform, Scale, Rotate, Skew, Distort, and Perspective. Also Warp. Warp is quite interesting. You can actually take the image and kind of mash it kind of like clay. It's pretty fun. Sometimes that's a necessary tool to get in there and just grab corners of it, see what I can do. I could grab this corner and push it like clay. Wah. Get that in there. Wah. Just push that to the edges. It's actually working for me pretty well now. There. And I'll probably turn it all the way back up again. And then I'll hit Return. I'll grab that now and tuck it underneath the foreground. I'll just tuck it underneath because we made a hole for it, right? And we're just going to tuck that underneath. Oh, quit moving around, Deeg. I had it. Okay, so get to there. I'll take a look.
Grab the magnifying glass, we'll get in there. Woo! Get in there. We need to manipulate the, see how that's covering up parts of the things? That's fine, but we do need to turn down the opacity, and I do want to delete away some things that it's covering up. It's covering up my gable here, so I will just delete that away, delete away any foreground, or yeah, background elements. Deselect. I will move now through the site. You can see any bits of stuff that are being covered up, I will delete away. Do a little bit of surgery in here. It's covering up some of my stuff. A few houses in here. Just want to erase away the edges. I can use a lasso in this case, or I can also use the erasing tool. Either way, I don't want too much of my plan to be covered up. I could grab the erasing tool, do that. Grab an eraser. That's an option for me. Boy, that's a big eraser. I don't know. That's a little bit better. Boy, that's a big eraser. All right. I can just erase away portions of this. I was doing fine. So I'm just cutting away around my new stuff so that it just sits in there, tucked in like it's ready for the night. Go back to 100% opacity. Now you can add cutout trees. I've deliberately selected a SketchUp view that had the trees turned off, or a plan view that had the trees turned off. In plan view, we could paint circles and they look like trees, right? I'll show you how to do that. But you won't have to have the ability to turn those off on the old layer. Doing in Photoshop, they're on their own layer. If you're doing trees in SketchUp, they're on their own layer, their own tag. SketchUp 2020 layers are now on tags. But if you keep all your trees on one tag or one layer, you can turn them off so that you can use Photoshop trees. Right? Yes? Good. Let's go to box. Go. To the box. And then you will see our assemblage of cutouts. Car cutouts, cars in plan view. We need more of those, by the way, so if you find some, please share them to the folders. People, diagramming elements, trees. So if we turn on gallery view or grid view, you can see a preview of these things pretty good. Is this a perfect assemblage? No, but there are four pages. So there's quite a few to choose from here. And so we can just start, you can start downloading those, or you can highlight multiple and download them as a set. your choice, but I encourage you to download to a thumb drive so you have it, and you can start placing trees directly into the image. Once you place a tree, I can drag and drop, or you can place it embedded. You can then start scaling them and placing them. The trees that are there are your hint. You want to make sure that you are placing trees that are in relative context to what you have around you. And then hit return to accept it, and you'll see that tree now is a smart object on its own layer. To duplicate that, right mouse click on the layer, you can duplicate that layer and you get another tree. Duplicate the layer, get another tree. Maybe it gets smaller as it gets in the background. Duplicate the layer, get another tree. You get a group of trees going. You can right mouse click these layers, and then either right mouse click or control click, you can merge those layers. So you don't get overwhelmed with layers. But I do recommend keeping the trees on their own layer, just in case you have to turn them off. There's more than one species, obviously. So let's grab a couple of different species. Scale it down. Put it into place. Get very small. We may want to zoom in a little bit. Okay. And then I'll just start duplicating that layer. Right mouse click, duplicate layer, get another tree. Right mouse click, duplicate the layer, get another tree. And so on. Right mouse click, duplicate layer, get another tree. Now, they can start not from this scale, because obviously we're looking at this from an aerial. This is pretty, not a lot of detail, but you know, when we'll do this similar operation for eye level perspective, the trees can start to look the same after a while. There's a danger of that. So there are tricks that I do where I can take a tree and flip it and make it look not like its neighbor. So if we take the pointer tool and we float over this tree here, I do a control click. You can see it's cut out tree, copy 3. That's all of them actually now because they were merged. But if you can, you can actually, you go to image adjust. There's a flip here. Edit transform, that's right. Under edit transform, you can actually flip a tree horizontally. In this case, it was a group, but that's one way you can make trees not look completely identical next to each other. I'll show you what I mean by that. If we zoom in closer here, you'll start to see these trees start to look pretty identical. And that can be a problem. So if we go to edit, transform, flip horizontal, you get a flipped image and it doesn't look as alike. Does it still look alike? Well, yeah, but it's better than it was. So if we isolate that and we edit, transform, flip horizontal, we can start to create a line of trees that are not exactly alike. Until we're satisfied with them, and then we can zoom out and start to group them. So see all these trees now in line. We can then merge those layers together. Okay. Take a look, see where you are at.